Okay, so we move to the second half of this morning's focus on the UK scene. And this, as you know, is looking in particular at the Green Deal, where we've got to in terms of the design and planning for the Green Deal, how things are shaping up. We've been talking about it for quite a while. The Energy Bill, of course, is going through Parliament, so there's lots of stuff happening at the moment and people trying to keep up with where the debate is. So we felt, on Ashden Awards, we felt it was very timely to bring this to the fore now and just to get a snapshot of how this is all turning out. So we've got five panellists to share the discussion with today, and I'm absolutely delighted that we've managed to get all of them here today. So I'm going to start on the outside right there. So that is Christoph Harwood. Christoph set up an organisation called Marksman Consultants, which is very involved in Green Deal planning and in particular has done some fantastic work in Birmingham on the Birmingham Energy Saver Scheme, which has been really interesting, and I'm sure you may want to comment on that, Christoph. Next to him is Dan Monzani from DEC. I already pointed to him and said, get yourself ready. As you can imagine, he's always ready because at the moment it's a busy old time for the lives of DEC civil servants, which is great. Next to him is David Hall. David used to be the international director for the Climate Group and then set up Behaviour Change, a nice juxtaposition going from very, very big to getting behaviour sorted out at that level. Next to him is Abigail Burrows from the Local Government Association, senior policy officer, dealing with a host of different issues regarding local government. And we had some interesting comments on local government in our earlier session, which I think was really, really useful and sort of flagged some of the concerns about that. And then immediately on my right is my colleague, David Adams, Director of Retrofit at Wilmot Dixon. I say my colleague because I have to declare an interest here. I'm a non-executive director of Wilmot Dixon, and David and I work quite closely on the retrofit story within Wilmot Dixon, which is great. So each of our panelists here has been given 5 minutes to introduce themselves and the sort of contribution they'd like to make to the debate. It is going to be rigorously chaired. If they haven't stopped speaking at the end of 5 minutes, I'm afraid they'll just have to shut up as we move on to the next person, because we do need to finish this session bang on the dot at 12:25, and I'm really sorry about that, just 5 minutes early for various reasons. So I'm going to be keeping fairly strict time. Christoph, I think you're going first.
Okay. Yes, good morning everyone. Christoph Harwood from Marksman Consulting. We're environmental finance consultants, so try to find the right financial solution for environmental problems. And we've been working for the last 18 months with the Energy Saving Trusts and also with the Sainsbury's Family Charitable Trusts on how to accelerate finance into energy efficiency programs for domestic housing. We're talking large scale, so we're talking really in billions. You know, the numbers coming out is we looked at a £70 billion program over the next 10 years. How do we get that scale of finance to come in? And numbers go bigger. Some people say it's 120 billion. I think it doesn't matter. I think we just know it's a hell of a lot. Now, when we started looking at that program, we felt that local authorities had a key role to play. They've got a key role for a couple of reasons. One is they are generally seen by the research as trusted parties around energy efficiency, around retrofitting. So this is both in the private housing and in social housing, but predominantly we're now looking at the private housing market. Secondly, local authorities do have access to finance through some of their borrowing schemes, through their capability of borrowing from central government through something called the Public Works Loan Board. And what we did was to put together a model whereby local authorities can basically help make a program happen. It can help make a program happen by working with the private sector. And we've been working very closely, as Jonathan mentioned, with Birmingham over the last 6-9 months. And Birmingham has shown really great leadership by picking up this mantle and working through the detail. And that has enabled others. So Newcastle now is also looking at this program and following on. And the great thing about Newcastle is because it's smaller than Birmingham, it's working how it can work together with neighboring local authorities to go beyond one local authority program to a multi-local authority program. Now, what that model says is that a local authority comes in with some finance, and there's a danger I can go off into the technical financial terms, but I'll try to avoid that. But basically, they come in with the finance to kickstart that program, to take a layer, which we call the first loss layer. So they're prepared to take some of the risk in the program. And by being prepared to take some risk, then we can get the banks to come in alongside them and also then to take part. So the first Birmingham program is looking at £100 million to 15,000 houses. And that is going out to tender next month I was in Birmingham yesterday taking part in a briefing session, and they're going to go out to procure a private sector partner to deliver that programme. So the private sector partner is a very important player because they not only make it happen, but they also play part in warranting the programme and standing behind it. We hear a lot of talk about warranties. Most warranties in the past have been directed at the house owner. If we're going to bring finance in, finance also wants some warranties, and they want to see somebody in there who says, who stands behind us? The banks say to me, who do I sue if this goes wrong? Yeah. So that is why we're looking at some major scale companies coming in on this. But also, clearly for local authorities, jobs are extremely important. And therefore, those local companies are very much also focusing on what happens on local jobs, local employment, and the startup of local firms. And so the idea then is to have a company set up this program and then go out and bring on 15,000 houses in the first wave. And Birmingham is looking at an option to extend that program out to 60,000 houses or a £400 million program, so decent scale finance. We believe the biggest risk in that is adoption risk. Can we sign up people? And we've heard earlier the challenge of signing up people, and I'm very interested in hearing some of the results from Radian, from Totnes, about the challenge in getting people to actually go into the program. It will be done through the Deep Green Deal legislation. We think it's a smart piece of legislation where you can collect the money over 25 years with the measures done up front. Where renewables are required or suitable, then we'll probably use the roof rental model, which some of you will know about, whereby the Birmingham fund that is set up will own the solar PV on the roofs. By deploying it out to that scale, you can then get some decent levels of finance to come in. Now, the aspiration is to, if we're going to get into the billions, is to be able to get local authorities working together on this so that they can aggregate these together into programs. And we start getting quite technical, talking about things like what's called banking warehouses. We start looking at the bond market. We start looking at how we're going to actually get it off the local authorities' books and out into the banking sector. And there's quite a lot of work being done on that. That's a piece of work being financed by the Sainsbury's Family Charitable Trusts. And talking to the bond market, what the bond market says to us, if we're going to come into this with the billions that you require, we need to see a market of about 10 billion. We need to see it coming to us in chunks of about 300 million. We need to believe that it's going to be coming on a regular basis over the next years. And therefore, really, the crucial thing about Green Deal, to get that volume, comes all the way back down to people. Because if we believe that people will sign up to it, and if the market, if the finance sector believes that people will sign up to it, then they will start putting their money behind it. So, and I think we are moving now from an era of when people talked about houses to talking about people. And I come back all the way through to the work that's been done about how do we get people to sign that up. And that is our biggest challenge.
Christoph, thank you very much. Dan Monzani.
Well, thank you. I agree with a lot of what Christoph just said. I'm Deputy Director for Green Deal Legislation and Finance at DEC, where my role involves coordinating the policy going into the legislation at the moment and specifically looking at the financing mechanism that I'll talk about in a second and some of the capital market funding options that Christoph's already talked about. In a nutshell, then, Green Deal is a framework which enables firms and individuals to invest in the energy efficiency of their homes and properties at no upfront cost and to repay through their energy bills. That last part, repaying through energy bills, is the really critical bit because, again, to sort of echo what Christoph said, if you focus on the individual rather than the property, the barriers that individuals have felt to investing in energy efficiency have included trust in the tradespeople and not knowing where to turn, which I'll come on to, but also crucially, quite rationally, not necessarily wanting to invest in a property's energy efficiency when the savings to pay for that work only accrue over quite a long term and they're not sure they'll be in that property. By attaching it to the energy bill, what Green Deal allows you to do is to pass on the liability to make those payments to the person who comes into the property subsequently and who is enjoying the benefits of that improvement. So it overcomes that primary financing barrier that's held back the market. The other barrier, as I said, is about trust. And so, you know, in order to protect this quite powerful new mechanism we've put in place, we've got a number of consumer protections. The first of which is the golden rule. That's the principle that says you cannot attach finance to the energy bill unless it is less than or equal to the expected savings from the work. That doesn't mean you can't part finance, so you can include measures that might be more expensive but you want for aesthetic reasons or whatever, but it means that the charge that goes onto the bill and can be passed on to someone else ought to be covered by the savings that that work will generate. Second protection is the Consumer Credit Act, which applies to this form of finance, although it's novel and it's not technically a loan, because you can't ever have the full capital amount called in on you, it is still protected by the Consumer Credit Act. That means, for example, that as well as testing the golden rule, the provider who comes in to offer you the service would have to check that you are likely to realise those savings. We recognise that some people who are in vulnerable households or who are having very major measures done might not always realise savings, and so that responsible lending test comes in and possibly flags things for further subsidy under the energy company obligation. Two other quick protections I wanted to mention before I talk about that obligation. Firstly, disclosure. So there'll be full disclosure requirements at the point where you rent or sell on that property, so that you're coming in, you know exactly what you're getting. You know you're getting a level of savings that should at least offset the costs. And then secondly, the accreditation schemes, which absolutely fundamental to trust, absolutely fundamental to financeability, because as Christoph says, you've got to know that the money's going to start, the thing's going to work, so the consumers are going to pay, so that you're going to get the money. That will include making sure products are able to claim the savings that they're claiming, that the assessor is properly trained and accredited, that the installer who does the work has a high standard of accreditation, and that the provider themselves who provide the credit meets those high standards that we would expect, at least as high as the Consumer Credit Act. And wrapped around all of that, redress and sanctions processes on which we've published a recent pamphlet. So my final point is simply to point to the energy company obligation, because I know many of you who will know about the basic framework will be thinking, well, hang on, how does this add up in some of the more difficult circumstances, like a solid wall property? And the simple answer is, for some of the most hard to treat properties, at current prices, without additional support, it might not add up. And that's why the government's putting in place the energy company obligation, which will require energy companies to support hard to treat homes and vulnerable consumers in a way that can be integrated with Green Deal, but enables those houses to be retrofitted as well. So that's all I wanted to say on the framework itself. As Jonathan says, we're going through Parliament right now. We're back into committee again tomorrow morning. We should, with touch wood, a bit of luck and parliamentary planning, have royal assent by the end of July, and then we'll be consulting on secondary in October.
Thanks, Anne. David Hall.
I mean, as Christoph says, I think possibly the biggest challenge about the Green Deal is how we get people to sign up. And that's a question we've been giving quite a lot of thought to. I guess the first thing you need to do to begin to understand that is sort of where are mainstream people coming from on this? And, the simple fact is the vast majority of people at the moment aren't falling over themselves to make their homes more energy efficient. We actually did a survey just last week in which 2/3 of people said they were planning to do some kind of home renovation over the next year, which I suspect is a bit of an overestimate. The vast majority of that, though, is people kind of saying they're going to redecorate a room. 8% of people said they were considering some energy efficiency measures. Now, on the face of it, that might sound reasonably encouraging, but actually, it does show, I guess, how small energy efficiency is in terms of the kind of top of mindness and salience for people. So I think when we go into sort of try and understand the barriers and what's preventing people from getting more engaged with this at the moment, there are really kind of three things that the research we do tends to identify. Firstly is that point that it's not particularly top of mind compared to a new kitchen or a sort of beautifully redecorated living room. You can see that kind of loft insulation and stuff like that is harder to get excited about. Secondly, and I think, to a degree that the point that Dan talked about, there is this perception that it's very expensive. Is this an investment that I want to make? And then thirdly, and perhaps most importantly, and I think that came up quite nicely in some of the discussion earlier, it's potentially incredibly disruptive. People see it as a big hassle. They might have to move out of their house. And I think particularly as we move from a time now where it's mainly been about loft insulation and cavity wall to a time when we're hopefully getting people to sort of completely retrofit their homes, we're looking at things like solid wall insulation and so on, it's going to be massively disruptive. And I think, the challenge at the moment is the Green Deal, as it's now seen through the legislation going through the Commons, really only tackles one of those barriers. So it does tackle the sort of upfront cost barrier. But clearly there's other stuff we need to think about. And I think, there is a danger of a kind of you know, a simplistic, caricatured version of the Green Deal is a bit of government legislation that allows people to pay some stuff back through through their energy bills, and some high street retailers and the private sector sort of champing at the bit to kind of market this and get people excited about it. And I think the reality, as I'm sure everyone here probably recognises, is there's a far more complex ecosystem of organisations that are going to be required in order to create the kind of societal shift that's needed to really get people wanting to do this. So obviously government has to take the lead. It's not just about legislation. I think it's about incentives, other signals that government sends out. It's about aligning the policies across the piece. You know, businesses big and small need to feel that it's worth their while getting involved, that it's going to be a big market. And actually, you know, contrary to I think what Jonathan was saying earlier, you know, there's been a lot of talk in the media about the big retailers and so on getting involved. Well, actually, when you go and talk to these guys, they're not necessarily quite, you know, behind the scenes, quite so positive about the business opportunity that the Green Deal is offering. Obviously, there's a role for local government, housing associations, charities. You know, the media clearly needs to be on side. Finally, just to pick up a few points, I think, that sort of have been raised earlier in the day. Firstly, you know, inherent in the Green Deal, there isn't necessarily a way of tackling the longer-term behaviour change that's required. We all know about the rebound effect, the fact that, you know, people are living in fuel poverty. What they're actually going to do probably is turn their heating up a bit and live in warmer, cosier homes rather than kind of take the energy savings. So, you know, if the models don't ring true and people aren't saving money, you know, firstly, that's obviously a problem for the workings of the Green Deal, but it's also an issue in behaviour change terms. How do we find ways to build into the Green Deal sort of methods for continuing some engagement with people and encouraging them to actually fully use the energy efficiency benefits that they can access? And then also, I think there's an issue, given today is a lot about sort of communities. You know, I do think, my perception at least, is that the Green Deal at the moment is primarily about individual homes, and the way it's being thought about is very much in that way. I think the role of community is as yet a little bit unclear, and potentially risks being a missed opportunity, partly because I think delivering the Green Deal on a community scale, obviously, as was demonstrated by some of the case studies earlier, is a far more efficient way of doing it. You know, if you can get teams on site delivering it through large numbers of properties, that's going to be cheaper. But also, there's a kind of motivation question there about, you know, can we get this social norming going? Can we get communities excited in the way that they've done in Totnes? And I'm not sure that's entirely sort of built into the thinking at the moment.
Thank you, David. Abigail Burridge.
Thank you, Jonathan. First of all, it's really good to be here because when we first went to see the new government, they said to us in no uncertain terms that there is no role for councils in the Green Deal. And we were sort of said, really? And I found it very interesting today with the questions and so forth that there is an unerring assumption that councils should be involved. And the enthusiasm from councils to continue to be involved. They're currently delivering around half the energy efficiency programmes in the UK, often in partnership. There is an implicit assumption that councils should be involved and a lot of them want to be involved. We've been battling, and I have to say, I think it's still a battle to get government, the new government, to recognise the role that councils can play. And I very much appreciate, you know, all the colleagues up here and other organisations for them also saying that councils have a really strong role. So it's not just the local government group or association whom you might expect. I think it's interesting because often the role that local government can play is really sort of undervalued. The planning role and the strategic overview that councils have of their local areas isn't really incorporated into what's going on climate change. It's interesting sort of hearing the gentleman from CAT talking about what I interpret as energy opportunity mapping. So overlaying, you know, what is the demand for energy? What is the housing stock like? Where are the opportunities to reduce CO2? And how can we generate energy in a low carbon way? And using councils' planning powers as well as that level of governance that councils have, that's one of the key assets as well. It's that level of governance nearer to local people than central government. And really, central government is missing a trick if it doesn't involve local government more. We have signed a memorandum of understanding with the Department for Energy and Climate Change that looks at ways to get councils motivated on the issue. But for me, the key part of that, we did get a statement that DEC said, or Chris Hume signed up to anyway, that councils are pivotal to action on climate change. So I think the next step is, the proof is in the pudding. We'll see whether we are involved in the policy discussions, the development, and whether the realisation of the key role that councils can play actually plays out in policy. I know there's a lot of concern about the loss of the national indicators and a real pressure for new statutory instruments to be introduced. But what we don't want are targets without the tools to do anything to meet those targets. There's no point having a target if you're not allowing councils to get involved. If there isn't a good policy there to help councils get stuck in, you can give us as many targets as you like. It doesn't mean we're going to be able to achieve them. What we are going to have, though, is the Home Energy Conservation Act is no longer going to be repealed. We haven't got lots of detail on that, but apparently that is going to be some sort of statutory instrument to get every council in the country involved in some way on the Green Deal. Previously, it's been very much a reporting mechanism where councils report on the average energy efficiency in their area, and we're very keen to understand exactly how it's going to get councils to act on the Green Deal, because there is huge enthusiasm for councils to act on the Green Deal. It's been great working with Christoph and the Energy Saving Trust, where a lot of large councils are looking to be Green Deal providers and actually use it as a local economic regeneration programme, because again, there was a question earlier about the involvement of the private sector and businesses. Councils very much are about local economic development. It's not just about councils leading, but how can they work with their local business community to get them involved in the Green Deal and create new jobs? Partnerships are also very important. I was with Scottish Power yesterday, and they said, you know, councils were their best partners, and they really want to continue to working with them in the future on the delivery of the energy company obligation. But we have to be careful about sort of reputational risk. I think the Green Deal is being very much seen as a private-led initiative. You know, 1,000 flowers blooming was said yesterday, lots of private sector companies. And if councils are going to be expected to promote the Green Deal, there needs to be some safeguards. From what I understand, people aren't going to make loads of money on the Green Deal. We need to keep interest rates really low. Where's the incentive? If it's all about selling other goods when you're in someone's home, there will be concerns from councils about whether they should be promoting that sort of programme. But generally, councils are very enthusiastic, and we look forward to the Green Deal coming on board and how we can use it.
Abigail, thank you. David Adams.
Hi, David Adams from Wilmot Dixon. Pleasure to be here. Wilmot Dixon are a main contractor, it's a large builder. And a potential Green Deal provider. We maintain homes, we build them, et cetera, et cetera. So this potentially fits. From a personal perspective, things are moving very, very fast. I know Dan's in a big team in DEC, which 12 months ago was about half a person, if I remember rightly. And I was working on this about 3-4 years ago to explore the idea, and we're here now, it's running through. And I think that momentum is extremely helpful, and this debate is extremely helpful. It's been mentioned a lot of times. Is this the panacea? Is this Green Deal going to solve it in terms of the financial element? Absolutely not. The margins here are very slim, and it will have to be delivered in all aspects, be it financial, be it engagement, be it work on the ground, extremely efficiently. Otherwise, the numbers just don't stack up. So that's where, if we're looking at major providers coming into this space, I'd love to see how we would fund huge marketing budgets, because the money just really isn't there. Someone has to pay ultimately. And in terms of, so therefore that kind of drives you to say, how do we deliver it efficiently, deliver it therefore locally, and engaging with people to do this, as opposed to a traditional adverts on TV route. Second thing is, Abigail mentioned reputational risk. Of course, that works both ways. Major companies are extremely careful about their reputation. I remember having a discussion with one major supermarket about 2.5 years ago on this, and they said, David, fantastic idea, but you realise every customer is worth about £60,000 to £70,000 to us. Because if someone gets upset, they don't just not buy their shopping from that supermarket next week. It's normally for the rest of their lives, yeah? Especially when you're dealing with the home. So I think here there are lots of pressures to get partnerships to work strongly together, to get finance in a form that it's structurally very efficient. And it was mentioned by a number of people here, it will need, I'm not allowed to use them anymore, sticks and carrots, but you know what I mean, nudges and incentives, I think is the correct term now with the new government, because otherwise, how do we get this to scale? It wouldn't matter if we needed to just grow this organically and slowly. Then you perhaps wouldn't, because actually I'm quite impressed by 8% thinking about energy efficiency. Great number. Bearing in mind, if 1% of dwellings were looking for this service, that would completely swamp any industry trying to deliver it at this moment in time because of the skills issue that had been mentioned. So 8%, great. I'm not looking for 80%. I'm worried at that point. But the point is, we will need sticks and carrots, nudges, to drive this to a mass scale across the short period that's being talked about between to 2020 and 2030. Bearing in mind, we're nearly done all the easy stuff, yeah? And we found that quite hard, so this gets much harder still. So a link, a little tiny bit on behavioural change. It is really important that we have satisfied customers. So this cannot be a case of wandering in, fixing technical measures, and walking away for two reasons. One, there's an ongoing relationship. The householder continues to pay this for the next 25 years. If they're upset, they will stop paying it, and that causes all kinds of problems, risk. So how do we maximise their perceived benefit and therefore real benefit of this is, of course, work with the technical measures and very much work with the behavioural side too, which is why, again, engaging with others to help deliver that efficiently becomes extremely important. I think also the fact it's really tricky is that will drive people working together. Because if it was easy, high margin, people were very protective. If they think there's a big opportunity there but genuinely don't know how to access it, I think people become more open. I'm not naive, it's still going to be competitive, but they will certainly work with a wider group of stakeholders, I think.
David, thank you very much. Right, well, some very interesting stuff there. Abigail, you would have been enjoying Dan's body language had you been able to see it from your peripheral vision as you started to lay out some of the complexities in terms of the relationship between local government and central government. Dan, I feel I'd better give you a chance to say something about that before your body language turns into something more violent.
Well, I hope my body language reflected surprise as much as anything. We've taken a very open approach to working with people. Now, one thing we certainly will have wished to communicate is that this isn't a state top-down set of targets and public sector delivery driven through either agencies or councils. It is very much a market framework, but it is also very much the kind of market that, that David's just described, where there's partnerships, where there's an incentive to get economies of scale and work locally, where there is a need for trust. And that's the approach we've taken with local authorities, both individually and collectively, to try and help them work and realise those opportunities, help work in partnership as they have within our PAYS pilots with the private sector to find the opportunities and to get over those trust barriers. But it is fundamentally a market opportunity because at the end of the day, people don't let people into their homes unless they want something doing. So you can't have someone in a deck overall going to every house and demanding that they do something. It has to be about working with local people who can find those homes that where people want work doing and incentivising that to happen.
I don't want to focus too much on what DEC could or couldn't do, but you could demand much more than you are choosing to at the moment. You could take advantage of the consequential improvements story, yeah. For instance.
No, we certainly could, although it happens to be a matter of CLG policy that's under consideration at the moment, and it may well be that that gets tightened in due course. No decision has been taken yet. We have done things, though, from the gentle nudges in behavioural terms, like requiring energy companies whenever they get notice that someone new has moved into a property to send neutral information about the Green Deal in general to that person.
because we know that when someone moves into a property, there's the opportunity to improve that property is easier because people are thinking about improving it anyway, right the way through to the tougher sticks, if you like, putting regulation on the private rented sector, so that from 2018 you simply won't be able to rent out a property if it isn't of a sufficiently high standard.
Great, thank you. Good. Okay, now we've got half an hour, so we've got some time to get stuck into this rich area. I've already got lots of fans to fill up the half an hour. I'd quite like to cluster, if it's at all possible. I know this will be really difficult, and you probably won't play ball with me. But is there a little cluster of hands who'd like to do the finance bit first? I was thinking about finance, and then partnership, and then behaviour change. Every hand in the room has gone down apart from one. That's either very encouraging or slightly worrying. Right, I'm going to start, if I may, with Philip in the middle there, and then I'll come to you at the back there. We'll just see where this goes, it looks like.
Jonathan, Philip Seward from the Energy Saving Trust, and I'm really pleased to be asking the questions for a change. My question is a combination of the finance and behaviour change. I'll make it brief. I've watched with increasing horror over the last 2 weeks as the Daily Mail is setting itself up as the people's champion against those energy companies, those in government, local and national, are looking to rip off the public through their energy bills. And I'm really interested in the panel's view as to how concerned we ought to be, because my real concern, and we've all emphasized it right throughout the morning, it's about people and it's about people taking action. I'm really concerned that our mass broadsheet is launching a major campaign basically saying we shouldn't be doing this. Government and companies are having us over. They're putting £200, was the figure quoted in the Daily Mail last week, on our energy bills, looking to double to £400 as a result of the Green Deal, renewables, and so on. How worried should we be, and should we not be on the offensive against this sort of activity?
Okay, that's a good one to get us going. Please, at the back there.
Hello, Tony from Eco Capital. I'm an investor, actually, in clean energy. I'd like to know what the working together with the GIF, with the GIB is, the Green Investment Bank, because that's what us investors are looking for as a support network. And the Green Deal sounds great, but the margins are very small, and you know, getting private money into doing this is going to be incredibly difficult without having the support of a very sophisticated Green Investment Bank. And looking at financial tools that are not currently being used.
Anything else on the Green Investment Bank? Because we didn't touch on that this morning. Please, at the back, the guy in the pink shirt there. Two forward, thank you.
Giles Bristow from Carbon Leapfrog. We work with a lot of community groups, sort of professionalise and bring in services to help them over their hurdles. Just really want to add to that. Should the Green Deal be sort of knitted together with the Green Investment Bank as it relates to community groups? Because these are the people with a lot of potential but struggling to finance these sort of initiatives.
Thank you. And one more here, and then I'll get to the panel. Just in the row there. The row in front of you. No, just wait a minute, John.
This is more about behaviour change. Do you want to do that later?
Yes, please, yes.
Okay.
Right, so quickly on the Green Investment Bank. I'll come back to the Daily Mail in a moment. Christoph, what are you, and David, I know you've been thinking a bit about this too. Christoph, thoughts about the Green Investment Bank and the interplay with the Green Deal?
Yeah, I mean, I think there is a role that the Green Investment Bank can play in supporting local authorities. And that really is, if you look at local authorities as kick-starting the process, getting the program, deploying some of their funds, tens of millions, to get the first houses to adopt it, is then they want to sell off the loan book and get some more money back to go and do some more. Now, the way a Green Investment Bank could help that is if you have a central organization who's buying these loan books, what the commercial bank says, who takes the first risk in that central vehicle? And that is not going to be really open to venture capital. It's not the sort of returns that you can get in there. So there's a bit of market failure. You need someone to take that first risk in that central organization. And I think that would be a smart place for the Green Investment Bank to sit, put its money in. It doesn't mean it has to run it. It doesn't mean it's all integral, but it's a case of financing a vehicle, an enabling vehicle, to help local authorities refinance their programs and then eventually get out into the bond market.
And that has now been flagged as a potential area in the first list of priorities for the Green Investment Bank, hasn't it? Not necessarily that specific role, but some de-risking role has certainly been flagged.
I mean, I was at something on the Green Investment Bank 2 days ago, and it was basically, we're listening. It wasn't as much as we are going to do something. Right. It's, okay. We are listening.
David.
I'd just make the point that this has to be structurally low interest rates, and it has to be attractive to investors. If it's not structurally low interest rates, meeting the golden rule becomes either you're just looking at very fast payback measures, or you're saying you need to apply more subsidy, which then gets socialised across energy bill payers, a la Daily Mail type criticism. So whatever can be put into place to end up with that financial structure, and also meeting the needs of risk, as is best met through the delivery chain in the best possible way, so everyone feels this is a really good, safe bet. And we've got to score that on every single front. I don't think we can be lazy in any respect. So I'm really pleased to see a slight warming from, let's put it that way, in terms of Green Investment Bank. I think it's fundamental, and I think people are waking up to the fact that it is so fundamental.
David Hall, did you agree with this David's characterization of how complex this is going to be? So low margin, complexity around the deal itself, golden rule, pretty difficult to make stick in all instances. Would you agree with that from your perspective?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's incredibly complex, and I think a lot of quite a lot of people have gone into this quite excited about it initially, done some initial development work, and begun to get quite worried about whether it's actually going to make sense for them as a business to get involved. And it's slightly different for, you know, the crucial difference for some of the local authorities and the model that Christoph's been working on is this sort of reasonably low-cost project finance that they can get hold of. And actually, for organisations who potentially can't do that, you know, it's really going to be quite difficult to make it stack up. And so I think the question is, you know, to what extent are the big sort of corporate players going to be going into this in a big way early on? And if they don't, is there a risk that the launch is a bit of a damp squib?
And you were implying that some of their initial enthusiasm has slightly wavered since then. Again, Dan's body language was getting a bit nervous at that point.
I mean, some of that is down not to the Daily Mail, but to some possibly a bit of media misrepresentation and a bit of sort of electoral PR, where I think a few names were bandied around in newspaper articles who perhaps weren't as far down the line as it was suggested.
Perish the thought that politicians took advantage of that. Who'd like to take on the Daily Mail here on the panel? That's what I'm waiting for now. Abigail.
I'm happy to start. We have something that we call the Daily Mail test. Local government generally gets a pasting by the Daily Mail, particularly around waste issues, rubbish collection issues. And before we do any policy work, we generally say, right, let's do a Daily Mail test. What's the kind of worst case scenario that a media organisation could interpret? And I think when we were going in to see DEC, a lot of the time I was saying, have you done the Daily Mail test on this? I think it is something we need to be aware of. I know in terms of the smart metering agenda, when that was being rolled out in other areas in Europe, you know, the media's role really influenced how people took it up and their perception of the rollout of smart metering. And I think it will be important, definitely on the Green Deal. And I think there is, you know, there is that danger that people might say, it's not delivering the savings. Because of this golden rule, you know, energy costs might go up anyway, and then, you know, your energy bill have gone up. Oh, but I've been told it should have gone down. And that's something that government and other Green Deal providers won't be able to control. But the perception, I think, will be really important. I don't have an answer about how to get organisations like the Daily Mail on board. We constantly send out positive press, but it doesn't always get taken up. So,
Dan, are you sitting around in DEC really worried about the Daily Mail?
No, I mean, we don't worry about any one specific approach disproportionately, but of course, where they're factually inaccurate, we routinely go back and correct them, and some of the reporting has been factually inaccurate. Yeah. I mean, it's one thing to report a £400 charge and then to completely ignore the £500 savings that charge pays for. I mean, that's just misleading, frankly. However, it's not all that bleak. Last week, we had 2 weeks ago, we had
I think, generally very good coverage of the document we put out around consumer protections, which really helps inform people that this wasn't going to be about cowboys. In fact, half of the Green Deal is about raising the bar so cowboys can't take part. Mm. So it's all about us being on the front foot, putting information out, rebutting misleading things. And actually, one of the nice things a couple of weeks ago was other people other than government, I'm thinking particularly of you, Switch, in one interview, coming out and actually saying, you know what, government's telling the truth here. It's not misleading. It is about consumer protection.
Good. I think, Philip, you've left a challenge hanging in the air, which is what we actually do about those campaigns and how to take them on. I'm going to move us on to another cluster now. Since we got halfway into behaviour change, I'll start there. Has anyone got a sort of question in that kind of area? I've got another hand at the back there, in here, and there. Okay, that'll do me.
Good morning. It's John Docker from Sustainable Energy Academy. My concern is that we are entering into a place of intense marketing without anything that we've yet defined as the product. It's almost like we're going into producing mobile phones or selling mobile phones, and we can't tell people yet what are the features, how much it's going to cost, or even what it looks like. And we're in grave danger of hitting a dull thud when this thing goes out, because we don't have the product that people can go and see. And therefore, they can't trust. I run a group of 100 houses now through the country which are open to the public and have saved at least 60% of the carbon, partly because of that. I'd just like to ask the panel, if they do see this as something which is intensely marketable at the moment, and if not, then what are the examples that we can point people to, and if there aren't enough of them, whether we should have a lot more of them in every local authority area?
Okay. Right at the back, please.
Roger Kelly from Energy Solutions. I'd just like to add to a lot of the concerns that have already been voiced from our own experience. We ran a project a few years ago funded by the Energy Saving Trust, which was in effect a dry run for the Green Deal, although the Green Deal hadn't been thought about. So we did exactly what the Green Deal is supposed to be doing. We did energy audits of ordinary householders' homes. We provided them with a program of both behavioral change and physical improvements. And we monitored their energy consumption over a year. And crucially, we offered interest-free loans for them to make the improvements that we recommended. Now, a lot of people on this program did take up behavioral change. A lot of people did loft and cavity wall insulation because there were grants or good discounts available. We had 100 households involved in this over the space of the project. Not one single household took up an interest-free loan because they weren't interested in borrowing money to do this kind of work. As has been mentioned, if they were going to borrow money, they wanted to borrow it for new kitchens, new bathrooms, even, interestingly, for double glazing, despite the fact that we could prove to them that the double glazing would take about 50 years to pay itself back.
Okay.
So there's a very interesting psychological issue here. And the question I really want to ask is, what is this message that we're going to get across, which is going to change people's minds?
Okay. Right at the back, please.
Shiv Malik from the Intergenerational Foundation. I just wanted to ask this, which is perhaps the group of in society that we're most willing to adopt these changes are sort of people who are under 35. They're kind of living in the wrong housing sector. By and large, they're living in the private rented sector, which has the highest housing costs. Obviously, people are kind of desperate to save, but don't actually have much capital to spend on this. And the other thing being, obviously, that in that sector, they have the shortest sort of tenancy rates. So in a sense, how do you kind of market to the under 35s? Again, they're going to live for a lot longer, and they can see their lives in 25 years' time. Whereas, you know, if you're sort of 60 or 70, that's sort of perhaps less of a horizon that you want to save over that time. So they're the perfect market, but they're kind of living in the wrong housing sector. How do you overcome that problem?
Right. Okay. I'm going to stop there. That's some good stuff to be getting along with. So, Dan, I'm going to come to you first on this one in terms of response to some of these issues. I mean, that's quite a dispiriting story, really.
But even interest-free loans, the Green Deal is trying to get around that by not requiring a loan of that kind. I mean,
I think the first thing to say is that, you know what, not mandating a particular way of financing something. If for some people they want to go through this and at the end of it they think, well, it's not that high cost and I've got equity in my house or I've got some money in the savings, they're perfectly entitled to just take advantage of the accreditation that we're putting in place and finance it another way. But for many people, in fact, I would say particularly the people that have just been raised at the back around private rented sector, no capital reserves, actually this kind of mechanism whereby you can attach your energy bills without the risk of being called in on the entire loan that pertains in loan agreements is actually very, very useful. Mm. And so not mandating people, but I think the feedback we've had is that this is really powerful for a lot of people. Just on PRS and the under 35s, as it were, I actually think the core Green Deal model does an awful lot for that group. One of the major barriers to investing in the energy efficiency of a rented property is a split incentive between the landlord and the tenant. Essentially, at the moment, we're asking landlords to put a large capital investment into a property and then watch all the savings accrue to their tenants. And particularly at the lower end of the market, where it interacts with housing benefits and so forth, it's very hard to recover that through rent increases. Green Deal overcomes that because the person who enjoys the savings on the energy bill also pays the charge on the energy bill. So we're helping overcome that barrier, and we're overcoming the upfront cost, as we've talked before. And finally, of course, because those barriers have been removed, we now think it's reasonable to signal regulation in the future that makes it unacceptable for landlords to rent out properties that are in poor condition. So I think those three things actually do really address that concern of yours.
Okay.
Concerns about over-marketing? I'm worried about that. I mean, David?
I'd like to think we're in that position. I don't think we're there yet. Of course we need more examples. And I think over the course of the next 18 months, 2 years, that will happen. Bearing in mind we're not trying to attract 50% of the population wanting one of these in the first year. If the market if it were to be that attractive, it would overheat and cause its own problems. Actually, we need a good, strong, steady build-up in this area such that we are able to build up a very reliable, safe proposition. So I think one to be watchful of, but I'm not sure I think there are bigger problems at the moment.
Christoph?
Yeah, I think when I did marketing, it was told the three rules in marketing: segmentation, segmentation, segmentation. So different people buy for different reasons, and it's very important to understand that. And what we're really looking at, when we look at Birmingham, we look at the offer that's going to go through, we're talking about early adopters. So early adopters, from the market research by the Great British Refurb, about 13% of the market. And they very much like the Green Deal idea. Now, you go through early adopters, early majority, late majority, and laggards. Now, laggards say over my dead body, and we'll have to come to that bit later. But the question is really, how can we work our way through that adoption curve? And we talk about sticks and carrots. As you go through the adoption curve, then you need to start bringing in different sticks and carrots. Well, let's work with the people that want to do it. This 15% traditional early adopter segment, I think, is out there. And going to David, 15% would be a great number to have to start off with. Let's work with those to get that going. Birmingham wants to do 200,000 houses. 15,000 in the first wave, that's 5%. So going back to Totnes numbers, that sounds like a good number to work with. Therefore, but let's have that horizon where we're heading for. In the long term, we do need to do 2/3, maybe more of the population. Let's get going, but start off with people who want to do it.
Okay, thank you. Right, another hand at the back there, and then can we come to the front here? You're probably free-ranging now, I imagine, rather than clustering.
Yes, Alina Congreve, University of Reading. We've heard quite a bit today about the suppliers trained and know what they're doing, but the suppliers who actually install the products aren't the only bit of it. There's also the people who actually have the goods to sell to those people. On the recent TSB projects, some of the later projects actually just ran out of things like cavity wall insulation materials because all the other early projects had taken them up. So as well as the person who actually fits the solar panel on the roof or puts the heating system in, what work is being done to make sure those products are actually available for the Green New Deal participants?
Thank you.
Katrin, maybe 7Y Energy Agency. The majority of home renovation and retrofit work is done by small businesses at the moment. We ran through our local partnership one of the successful PAYS pilots, and we didn't have any problem offering the low interest, the zero interest loans. But the important part from our point of view was that we have over 100 local small businesses delivering a whole range of sustainable energy technologies. And in terms of the quality side of this and the upskilling, it's very clear to us that you don't want to send plasterers back to school to learn how to pick up a trowel. It's a marginal upskilling they need, which they gain by experience. And we believe that you're only going to reach the large number of homeowners if you make this mainstream and normal. And so the regular trades that people go to get work done on their homes are offering the full range of sustainable energy technologies as a normal process. And my question that relates to this, I was coming to a question, I'm sorry. The cavity and loft insulation industry over the years of government intervention has evolved into one dominated by a very small number of large companies. So my question is, why did that happen and how can we avoid that happening to the rest of the energy efficiency industry?
Okay. So anything else on supply chain issues? That seems to me a rich sort of theme there. Is yours roughly skills and supply chain? Okay. I'll take this as the third one, and then we'll have one more round after this.
Hello. I'm Kath Peasley from Dulles. We've been working in renewable energy for 30 years, working worldwide. It's following on from the last comment, actually, which is supply chain, partners, and winners and losers. We've been working, as I said, for a very long time. There are many other small businesses. We're part of that. There are thousands of jobs involved with those small businesses. We heard recently with Chris Hume talking about winners and losers. So we have a concern here, following on from the last question, a few big companies left. Will the winners here be the utilities, the few big companies? What safeguards, what measures may be put in place for the supply chain, for the small businesses, the thousands of jobs that the pioneering people like ourselves have been supporting? Thank you.
Right.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you. Dan, I'm going to save you up till the end here, but just to get this round of answers going, what, has Chris Hume settled now on a specific number of jobs which the Green Deal will be created? I've seen five different estimates in the course of 1 year. Is there one that is now absolutely firm?
Oh, it obviously depends on what timescales you're talking over and so forth, and the level of ambition is certainly very high. I think the figure Chris Hume most frequently talks about is 100,000 jobs being created in the sector over the course of the next 20 years or so. But, you know, other things
are different.
Just wonder
which one we'd settled on, but that's good. Right, so there are some big crunchy issues about supply chain stuff here, and they clearly will have a big impact on the way those economic multipliers then bring the benefits through the economy. Abigail, did you want to talk about that?
Not specific. I do have some other points on those questions, though.
Okay, I'll come back to you in a minute. Anyone wants to talk about the supply chain? Christoph?
Yeah, and I think it's clearly when we talk to local authorities about the model, you know, we all talk carbon, but jobs really is important, and that is driving a lot of their interest in what we're doing. And one of the issues, at the end of 2012, we see the end of the current supplier obligation program, the CERT and CESP, and it moves into Eco and Green Deal. And if it takes you 18 months, which is probably the minimum, to set something up, actually, there's not a lot of time to get going on this. It's about moving now to make sure something is in place in 2013. So that is focusing some minds a bit. Now, we have this dilemma where the finance sector says, we like big companies because they're financially secure. Uh-huh. But we do. Therefore, we want someone in there who we can sit behind this program. Local authorities say, well, we want jobs. We want small companies on the ground doing it. And it's how do we reconcile those two things? We need large-scale money. We have to actually listen to the finance sector. And the way we're working it through in the model with Birmingham and Newcastle and the others is you have a core company who's responsible for delivery, but actually they are obliged to look to local people, local jobs, to deliver the work. And getting that balance is clearly something that has to be negotiated. But so far, not one of the large companies has resisted that pressure. They understand it. They've all got case studies of how they can deliver it. Now, the proof of the pudding will be in the eating, but I know very much that, yes, we all talk about carbon, but actually, when you get people emotionally in the local authorities, it is about jobs, and they're very keen in investing in this because of jobs.
Yeah, thank you. David?
Take them in turn. First of all, product availability. Until recently, I worked for a product manufacturer, in fact, made loft and cavity wall insulation. A lot of investment in that area. Why? Because there was a market. And actually, there's a lot of work going on in the background developing products in the hope of a future market. But the more confidence people have there will be a market, the more investment they'll put into that. So I have no worries there. Yes, there will be shortages at times. That pushes up prices. Therefore, people then invest more. That's a normal cycle. In terms of the small businesses, big businesses question, actually, loft and cavities went towards large businesses, frankly, because of the subsidy schemes, and energy suppliers, of course, want to rationalise their supply chain. So that was completely understandable. That could happen again. Actually, as Christoph said, it could be worse, because it's now not just the subsidy, it's the main finance behind this that isn't a one-off sell where the money's passed over. It is a continuous relationship. Yeah, so I think this is very, you could construct this, you can construct this in a way it will work for small businesses and large businesses, but that needs to be thought out very carefully, otherwise there will be unintended consequences and inevitably therefore swing into the large business direction. And I think this is more than just a bit of sentiment, we'd like it to be small businesses. I think structurally, it needs to be built in a form that actually will happen. And I think that's pretty predictable. You can look at a model and have a reasonable guess which way it will go.
Just coming back to Catherine's question as well, the way government has been selling a lot of the Green Deal, it is using the big brand names. The large supermarket chains to try and get people, I suppose, to take an interest and perhaps give it credibility. But again, we are pushing for recognition that councils are doing a lot on this. I know there was recently a visit by Chris Hune to the British Gas Big Apprenticeship Scheme, but at the same time, Birmingham is doing its own apprenticeship schemes. And I know Birmingham weren't particularly happy that British Gas was at the top and the main focus of that particular article, and Birmingham, I think, was the last name on the list. And I think from the discussions we've had today about the role of local authorities, we'd like to see Birmingham up at the top, perhaps above British Gas.
David, do you want to say anything about this?
Well, I think, you know, this is slightly outside my area, but, you know, to me, it boils down into two questions for Dan, probably. One is, you know, how is eco going to be set up so that it can be accessed by small businesses? And, you know, my understanding is that CERT at the moment, essentially, it's up to the energy companies to manage that process. That probably can't continue. And then secondly, you know, and this is an area obviously more outside of government's control, but, you know, how can finance, you know, when we're talking about securitization and some quite big ticket, complicated things that very small businesses wouldn't possibly be able to conceive of doing, how can that be made available to those organisations?
Okay, so panellists are now beginning to ask the question, so and the acronyms are beginning to fly, which is always slightly worrying. So, Dan, last word to you, just to bring that to conclusion, then we're going to have to wrap up.
Well, so a very brief word on supply chain, which is to say that I totally accept the points about confidence being what drives people to be able to make sure all parts of that are in place, and that's why we're trying to get out there and give people confidence that we're moving at pace, we're hitting all our milestones, there will be a big market there. We're doing the regulation that requires some of the demands. It's one of the reasons for doing the private rented sector regulation. And the Chancellor said in his budget that as a sign of the government's commitment, that he would act to encourage and incentivise the Green Deal in the last budget. So don't doubt our commitment to this. And we really want to give confidence to the industry. Second point, I think it's a really interesting discussion around how you engender competition in all aspects of the supply chain. It isn't just a big versus small kind of debate. It is just genuinely about how can different types of firm compete on a level basis. And I think I'd probably agree with David's analysis, or both David's analysis, about some of the reasons why large firms, if they did dominate in the past, might have been because of structural reasons. CERT, the previous subsidy approach with energy companies, did drive energy companies to having bilateral relations. And we are looking at how in the design of ECO we make that more open and we make it easier for energy companies to open it up to a wider range of people. The second reason I suspect why big brands, and I mean brands rather than firms, dominate or can dominate in a number of markets is around trust and recognition.
And that's again why the accreditation schemes are so important, because if you can look at a local builder and know they're of a sufficient quality because they've got a trust mark that you recognise, then that levels the playing field for that organisation.
Dan, can you wrap up?
Yeah, I'll wrap it up. I just want to make one final point, which links back into the marketing we've talked about before. One of the reasons we've kept Green Deal so broad is precisely so that the local guy going into someone's house because their boiler's broken and they want to replace their boiler, or because they want to replace their windows, or because they want to do solar panels because they're more visible, is able to say, well, I can access the Green Deal, which means why just do the boiler? Why not insulate the property at the same time at no upfront cost? And so it's precisely why we've created the scheme the way we have.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much to all our panelists. I hope that that's been instructive. It is fascinating to reflect on where this shows we've got to here in the UK. I'm very struck by this discussion about sticks and carrots and nudges and incentives. Let's hope we don't go from nudges to winks, because otherwise we know we're in serious trouble. But I was talking to the sustainability partner from Accenture the other day, who just come back from a visit to China, which was a rather different reflection on this, where they're doing a rollout of smart meters to 75 million houses, all of which will be completed by 2013. And guess what? There is no choice about this. This is what will be done. So we don't quite have that here in the UK, which I suspect we're all quite pleased about, but you can tell it does ramp up the complexity of brokering all of this through so many different players. For me, this discussion, however, has to be seen from a very encouraging and, I think, sort of inspirational point of view. Lying behind all of this, remember, is the Climate Change Act. We are still the only country in the world that has one of those, a statutory instrument of that kind, which has required our government to confirm its commitment to some breathtakingly ambitious targets by 2027, which then have to be rolled out. And guess what? The Green Deal is by far the biggest and most important part of the way in which those targets will be met. So remember the cascade here. It took a lot to get the Climate Change Act in place. It's still there. It's a really important part of the overall inventory we have around the low-carbon economy. And you can see now in the quality of this discussion, the numbers of people involved in it, you can see how that stuff is beginning to reach into places in UK society which previously might have been off-limits to this kind of idea and practice. So I think that's, on the whole, pretty encouraging. I hope I'm not trying to editorialise your own conclusions at the end of a fascinating discussion, and thank you all very much indeed to our panellists. This is our lunch break now. You need to be back in here at 2 o'clock, promptly for the start of the international session. And could I ask you to thank all our panellists in the usual way. Thank you.